Hi everyone. In today's video, we're going to dig a little bit deeper into inheritance within Java. What we're going to talk about today is one of the nice things about how Java does object-oriented programming and inheritance, and that is all reference types within the Java language inherit from the object class. I'll go into what that means here in just a second with some code. But at a high level, what that means is all objects that are made with the Java language have some implicit similarity in how they're handled, and they have some common methods and attributes that they can all use. In this video, I'll go through those various methods, and I'll explain a little bit about how the Java language actually does the inheritance implicitly with object. Let's get into some code and see how this works. All right, so I've got the same code up here that we used last time in our previous video on inheritance. If you haven't checked out that video, I'd highly recommend you look at that one first. Just to summarize where all the code is, we've got a main method here within our main class, and we have an athlete class, which is our base class for all of our other subclasses within this example. Our athlete class contains three public methods: train, rest, and eat. And then if we go to each of these other four subclasses, we'll look at hockey player, for example. It extends the athlete class, meaning within Java, we are inheriting the properties of the athlete class that are considered public or protected into the hockey player class. And then we have this additional public method called shoot the puck within the hockey player, because that is specific only to the hockey player class. Likewise, when you look at our dancer class, we've got the public dance method, and the dancer extends athlete, meaning it has all of athlete's public and protected methods. Our baseball player has a play ball method, and our basketball player has a shoot hoops method. Now, when we look at our athlete, we have these three public methods. So you might expect these are the methods that we can call on our athlete, but there are actually additional things we can do with our athlete that are common to all objects. Before we get into that though, I'm gonna go ahead in our main class and I'm going to create just a regular old object. So just like we normally create objects, there is an object class provided by the Java Lang package, which is, as it says, the root of the class hierarchy. Every class has object as a superclass. All objects, including arrays, implement the methods of this class. So when you think about what that means that all of our objects, even our main class here, all of these are implicitly extending object. Let's go ahead and prove that out for a second. What all does the object class provide, you might ask? Let's find out. If we use the dot operator, we can see the full list of everything that IntelliJ might suggest we could do with our object. There's a lot in here, and one thing you'll notice is that on the left, you have different icons. So if we go to the very top, this kind of grayish icon, this isn't indicating a method or a field of object. This is indicating something that the IDE can autocomplete for you. So we've used this shortcut before, sout, which is short for system.out.println, and you can see it's indicated right here. So this isn't actually calling a method within object. Well, technically not directly, it's actually calling to string, but that's beside the point. That's not a direct method call with an object like some of these other ones are. So if you look at the next one, this is hash code, which has this little circle with an M in it. That means that this is a method. So within the object class, we have a hash code method that takes no parameters and returns an integer. We also have a wait method, a notify method. We can have IntelliJ generate a lambda expression for us, which is a relatively complex Java topic we can get into in the future. We have a couple other wait methods, an equals method, toString, get class, and notify all. And if you scroll down, there are plenty of other things that IntelliJ can automatically start for us, but I'm not going to get into these right now. So all of these indicated here that have an M in front of them, these are methods that anything that is a reference type in the Java language should be able to access. That includes both any of our objects that we create or any arrays. Let's go ahead and test that theory really quick. So if I delete this, first thing that happens before I even use any of our objects that we created in the main method, we pass in a string array called args. So if I do args dot, I get a few methods that I don't get an object, kind of like clone, and I've got this length field, which we've talked about in the arrays video. But you'll see that I do have hash code here. If I keep going down, eventually, here we go. Now we'll see that we have an equals, to string, get class, notify, notify all, and our wait methods. So that shows us that arrays have all of the methods that object has. But let's say instead of going through this list of methods, I want to make sure it actually is an object. There is a way that you can do that in Java. There is this thing called the instance of operator. So I can say if args instance of object. Otherwise, I'll print false. Let's see what this prints. And as you can see, that prints true. The instance of operator does two things. It checks to make sure that a value is either a subclass or a direct instance of a particular type of object, or it also makes sure that the value is a null. So I would expect this to also return true, for example. So now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna demonstrate that this instance of property doesn't change even when I cast my variable differently. So now I'm going to go ahead and create an object called object args equal to args. Now if I set object args here, now I can check whether object args is an instance of string, and this should still return true. As expected, that does return true, but now what I can also show is I can show a case where this would return false because I know that my object arguments are not an athlete. And that's an example of instance of returning false because our object args is an object which was cast from a string array, but not all objects or string arrays are considered athletes because our athlete is an object rather than our object always being an athlete. Example of that is a square is always a rectangle, but a rectangle is not always a square. So now that we've demonstrated a little bit about what the object class can do, let's verify when we create an athlete that we can call all of the methods on athlete we would expect, eat, rest, and train, but then now we can see all of the object methods as well. Equals, hash code, to string, all of the ones that we've been talking about here. So as you can see, even though our class doesn't mention extending object, I can go ahead and do that here, but it doesn't do me any good because I already know that I extend Java lang object and the IDE is already even telling me that. So it asks, do I want to remove redundant extends object? I'm not gonna do that quite yet. I just wanna demonstrate that when I look at my method list, nothing has changed. So when you are implicitly using something that extends object, you don't need to include this. It is implied from how the Java language interprets your objects. One thing we haven't explicitly touched on is another property of Java inheritance is that it's what's called transitive. So the transitive property says that if 1 equals 2 and 2 equals 3, that 1 must equal 3. So what we mean by that is because the athlete class extends object and the hockey player object extends athlete, therefore the hockey player also extends object. So let's go ahead and verify that. Let's make a hockey player. So if I do player dot, I can see that I can use the eat, shoot the puck, rest, and train method. So these are defined in the hockey player class, and these three are defined in the athlete class. And then all of these methods are defined in the object class. Wow. Okay, so as you can see, this guy's kind of the limit here. That subclass gets access to literally everything that any parent above it had, all the way starting from object, which is the root of the class hierarchy. So now the last thing I want to do is I want to go through what some of these object methods are. Some of these things are a little more complicated, so I'm not going to deep dive every single one of them, but I'm going to go through a few examples. So let's say we look at the equals method first, and we'll just use a new athlete just so that this compiles for a second. If you hover over equals, it gives the documentation for what the equals method does. As you can see here, there's a lot of information. The gist of it is that when you want to make sure that two object references equal each other, not directly the reference itself, but what the reference points to is equal, you can use this method. So if I were to run this, for example, what do you think this will output? Interesting. So that returns false. So depending on how you choose to implement the athlete class, you may choose to want to make this sort of situation return true. If you wanted to do that, you would do what's called overriding the equals method within your athlete class. And that gets into what we call polymorphism within object-oriented principles, which we'll discuss more in a future video. The point being that the object class defines default implementations for these things, and they may or may not always be what you want. Now, if we go to the next example, let's go ahead and look at hash code. So hash code returns an integer. And now I'm going to go ahead and print the result. Okay, so what is that number? Well, this number doesn't have a lot of significance other than that the hash code, generally speaking, should be unique among objects. And basically, you can use the hash code as a debugging mechanism, or in the case of other Java data structures, sometimes those data structures use a hash code in order to uniquely identify an object. Because when I'm reading code and I'm trying to uniquely identify an object, I might just look at a variable name. But when this gets run on the computer, variable names aren't used, and instead you're looking at the object reference directly. All right, so now the next thing I want to show is the toString method. I'm going to go ahead and do athlete.toString. Let's go ahead and run this. All right, so as we can see, the toString method has the class name, an at symbol, and then this hex string. Now, one thing you might notice is that this hex string and this number actually are pointing to the same thing. If I copy this and pull up a calculator, go to Programmer, hit hex here, and I copy this, the decimal version of this, you'll notice, is exactly the same as the hash code that we printed out. So what the default method implementation of toString does is it calls the class name, throws an at symbol, and then adds the hash code to it. What's the significance of that? Well, the default implementation typically is just used for debugging, but it's kind of up to you how you want to represent your objects. If you, again, want to override the toString method, it's something you can do and I can show in a future video. But the next thing I want to show is that when we call println here and we give an object in here, what happens is when we want to convert an object to a string, the toString method is automatically called for us. So I can remove this and show that the output is exactly the same. And as we can see, the result doesn't change here. What happens under the hood is when you want to convert an object into a string, you're automatically calling the toString method. And that results in this same output here. All right, now these last two methods within the object class are a bit more complicated. The getClass method, so this is returning a class object and then whatever this garbage is. So this is what we call generics in Java, and that is a subject for a whole other set of videos that I can go into in the future. The gist of it is when you want to get a reference to the class that your object is, then you can use the getClass method, and that can be a way to identify the particular type of class you have. And then another method within the object class is notify and notify all. These have to do with threading. Basically, when you want to notify a thread when it is ready to begin execution again, or when it is finished waiting. And then these wait methods are going along with notify. The wait indicates, hey, I want to wait for a certain period of time. These five methods are relatively detailed things we'll get into in future videos and how multi-threading works. But one of the really cool things about Java is that multi-threading was thought of at the very beginning of the language because, as you can see here, these methods are included within the object class, and threading was thought of right away within the Java language when it was first created. And there you have it, all reference types, that would be all objects we create as well as arrays, all inherit implicitly from the object class. There are a lot of little caveats with using methods that come from the object class, such as the equals and hash code contract, or how you override things with toString, or how you deal with threading with the notifying and the wait methods. And all of those are great topics for future videos. I'm really excited to get into talking about some of those with you guys in the future. I hope you liked this video. If you did, please do smash that like button. Thank you for taking the time to watch today. I hope to see you next time, and have a good day. Take care.